Today we're talking code, and I want to walk you through my first professional coding project. This year I have been learning to code. I've been learning to code the designs that I build. I previously did have some basic understanding of HTML and CSS, like I was able to code my own website, charliemarie.com, just by hacking away mostly and Googling a lot of things. But recently I've been coding professionally at my job. I've been learning to use Git and GitHub and the SAS system that we have set up. And today I want to walk you through my first proper coding project that I really undertook at ConvertKit. It's the site for our conference that happened a couple of weekends ago at the end of June. The conference was called Craft and Commerce, and it was part of my job as the marketing designer to create the site for the conference, to create a place for attendees and potential attendees to go and find out all the information that they need to know about the event. I am going to do a whole separate video about learning to code and how I've been doing that, what services I've been using or whatever, but today I thought it'd be fun just to walk through this first professional coding project that I've created. Show you how it's set up, how I did it, and tell you about some things that I learned along the way. So this is our conference site, and the first thing that I'll note with this is that on ConvertKit.com we use WordPress, and I didn't create a whole new theme for this conference site. It's not a separate site, but rather it's just a page template within WordPress. I did it this way because I wanted to make use of things like the existing type styles and spacing and the Bootstrap grid that we use so that I didn't have to repeat all those things. So rather than create a whole new theme for this conference section, instead it's just a page template and I used a separate SAS file with all of my specific conference styling in it. I'm going to leave a link in the description where you can go learn more about SAS actually, because I don't think I'm qualified enough to explain it, but basically it's when your CSS is separated into parts and it makes the whole system much easier to work with. So if we look over here at the coding side, I've got this fancy split screen setup so I can show you. This is technically the conference page template that I select in WordPress. And it's got the navigation in it, and it's got the footer in it. And in the middle here, you can see this bit that says, get the template part, conference content. In conference content is where I have it fetching all the various individual pages that I had set up, because most of the site is static. There's only a few pieces in it that needed to be dynamic. For the most part, it seemed like it was just going to be easier to code everything as static HTML. So what this piece here does is it says, when it's the speaker's page, you're going to fetch the speaker's content, etc. The speaker's page was one of the most challenging. This is one of the places where I did use dynamic content. So as you can see at the top here, we've got all our speakers, and this works as navigation to directly drop down to their bio as well. And then yeah, each speaker has a bio with some social media links and the time that they're going to be speaking. Now I also use the bios on the overview page. If you click on the speakers here, then you also get their bio popping up in a modal window. And I did the same on the agenda. So because I was using this bio in three different sections, I obviously didn't want the speaker's information to be static, because that would have meant that if I needed to make a change, I would have had to update it in all three places, and it would have really bloated my code, and there was no need for that. So this is one thing that I did use dynamic content for. What I did for speakers was create a custom post type in WordPress. So that means that it appears at the side here, and I could add a new speaker. And within each speaker, I set up a few different custom fields using the custom fields plugin, just for their bio, a photo, the time they're going to be speaking on the stage, and the name of their talk as well. This meant that I set up every speaker in WordPress, and it meant there was just one place to come and update if I needed to make a change to their talk title or their bio or their photo or whatever. And when the speakers were added or updated in WordPress, they automatically fed into various places on my site. And let me show you the code for this. So on our speakers page, I have set up here that it's calling that specific post type, and then the code obviously tells it what to do with that post type once it fetches it. That's a real professional code explanation there, isn't it? I don't know how much detail you want to see in this, but you know, I use pieces of PHP to like fetch the speaker name and put underscores within it so that I could use it as a anchor tag. For the bios, I've used yet another template part, so let's jump into that. So even though this is on the page, like what, 14 times, however many speakers we had, I just had to code this one block and then it would repeat itself automatically. And then for when the bio appears in the modal, so on the overview and the agenda, I had a different template part, just because even though the layout's pretty much the same, it needed something slightly different to be able to have that, you know, cross at the top and appear as a modal. So that was fun. That was my first experience learning how to use custom post types and to use PHP to put content in different places. I actually really enjoyed it. There was a lot of struggles with getting my head around it and figuring it out. A lot of mistakes were made, but got there in the end and it all worked, which is good. Another place where I use custom post types is the attendee page. So we wanted to have a page that featured all of the people who were going to be attending the conference, because at a conference, especially a really good quality conference, the attendees are just as valuable to speak to as the speakers themselves. It's handy to know who's going to be attending and who you can make connections with, because networking is a huge part of any conference that you go to. And so we wanted to build this directory. This page features all several hundred people who attended. I can't remember the exact number in the end. I think it was close to 300. And how these people got on this page was by filling out this form here. So this is a gravity form. We use the Gravity Forms plugin for this. Using the Gravity Forms and Custom Fields plugin, it would then feed the information from this into a post type in WordPress, and it would appear here. I made them all appear as pending so that I could go in and check that the person was actually attending the conference before I approved them to put on the page, but I am looking at ways to automate that for next year. Then in the code for the attendees page, pretty much just like with speakers, I was using this PHP to fetch all the relevant content and put it into the right places. And again, the code works in a loop where it just keeps fetching until it reaches the end of posts in that post type. This is where I started to see the true power of using custom post types in dynamic content like this, because imagine how long it would have taken to individually, you know, put in all these people's names and links and photos into some static HTML. That would just be way too much work. So I'm glad that I struggled through and figured this out with a lot of help from Dylan, who is the other designer and developer at ConvertKit. One of the main problems I ran into with this part of the site in particular was photos, because even though I put in directions to upload a square photo that was below a certain file size, people often didn't listen to that. It's just a thing that happens, you know. And if the photo wasn't exactly square, then these nice circles that you see here would actually turn into ovals, because these circles are made just by putting a border radius on the image. And so to handle this, we had to write a piece of code that would take the photo when the form was submitted and automatically crop it before it was then put into the page, which was very far above my head. I had to do a lot of Googling for this and get a lot of help from Dylan on it as well. But still, it was a good learning experience. So it's basically this part in our functions file that it only happens on this specific form, form 21, as you see here, and it resizes the image. That was definitely for me the hardest part of this whole site coding process. The rest of it was mostly about getting my head around our code base, figuring out how we do things with the SAS system that's in place, and yeah, learning what styles we already had that I could make use of so that I wasn't duplicating things, and just remembering how to work with Bootstrap again as well, because it had been a long time since I did that, and like I said, I'd never done it in a professional setting before. Another little quirk that I learned while doing this was how to get these alternating white and grey backgrounds here. Because, like I said before, I wasn't coding these statically, so I couldn't individually apply a different class to each section that I was working with. Instead, I learned how to do this nth child thing. So I had it set that every odd number of a div with the profile class attached to it would get this grey background color, and everything that's not would obviously just stay white. So that was pretty cool to learn. That's really come in handy in a lot of other places as well. Another thing that I learned was how to work with Flexbox, although it still trips me up a lot of the time. But things like these points here, if I wasn't using Flex, then this line wouldn't continue throughout all of them. They would sort of like be jumbled around. So that was really good to learn about as well. Same with these boxes, that Flex just helps them be the same height. This ticket box was another one that was really tricky and I had to get help from Dylan on. You wouldn't expect a line to cause so many issues, right? But it did. But again, got there in the end. That reminds me, another thing on the speakers page that I learned was about order. See how these alternate with having the picture on the left and the right. But when you resize it, I wanted the picture to always be at the top. So I had to use the order property to apply to every odd number as well, so that when it was at this specific breakpoint, the picture would be order one and go at the top. Does that make sense? I hope that makes sense. Overall, building the site was a really great learning experience. I'm glad that I designed it before I started coding and before I realized how tricky some pieces would be to code, you know, because I think that I don't ever want my coding abilities to limit my design abilities. I think it was a really great project to just dive in headfirst to coding in a professional environment with, because there was a lot of things that I had to get used to, like shipping at various points. We had to put the overview page up first and then later add to it with the agenda and everything else. It got me in a really good habit of using Git and committing, etc., and things like that that I didn't understand before. And if you don't understand that either watching this video, don't worry. I think I'll mention it in my video about learning to code when I do that. But yeah, I'll leave some resources down below in the description as well. Thank you for watching this video. I hope you enjoyed hearing about this project and, you know, the things I learned along the way. If you've got any questions about it, then I would love to hear them. Leave them down below in the comments and I will answer them as best I can. You can also check out the site for yourself. That'll be linked in the description. Give this video a thumbs up if you did enjoy it. And if you're learning to code as well and running into difficulties like I am still, then I just want to say keep pushing and keep going for it. Ask a lot of questions, Google a lot of things, and just keep trying because it's a lot of fun when it all works out in the end. All right, thanks for watching. Have a good day and I will see you next time.